This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
مؤشرات توحي باقتراب تحقيق واشنطن هدفها بتجديد
Tehran announced today that it is restudying the proposals put forward by the US, Russia and France of trading uranium for atomic energy amidst indications that Washington is getting close to achieving its goal of imposing new sanctions on Iran.
تولاها رئيس هيئة الطاقة الذرية الإيرانية علي أكبر صالحي الذي قال ان تلك
The head of the Iranian Atomic Energy Agency Ali Akbar Salehi made this announcement by saying that those proposals will stop Iran from enriching uranium only if all of Iran's conditions are met in the trade for enriched uranium. Salehi said that from now on, the continuous production of 20% fuel is on the agenda, and that the first 5.3 uranium capsule for injection is ready at the Natanz facility. Iran talks about a new proposal to resolve the crisis comes at a time when the U.S. is running its diplomatic wheel in order to gain support for imposing new sanctions on Tehran. The U.S. Secretary of State did not hide her relentless effort to justify the cause. Clinton, who was heading from Qatar to Saudi Arabia today, expressed her country's fear that Iran is turning into what she described as a military dictatorship. Abdul Latif Al-Omar has the report.
This appears to be the strongest diplomatic campaign launched by the U.S. administration to put pressure on Iran to stop its nuclear program. A large part of the U.S. Secretary of State's speeches in Doha focused on foiling the program. Clinton explained in detail the reasons that prompted her country to request imposing more international sanctions on Tehran, viewed as the only way to convince it to give up its nuclear ambitions. She denied that the U.S. has any intentions to attack Iran, but said that the UN cannot remain silent on this matter. She expressed her fear that Iran is on its way to becoming a military dictatorship in which the Revolutionary Guard subordinate organizations will replace the government.
I would like to figure out a way to handle it in as peaceful an approach possible. And I certainly welcome any meaningful engagement. But we don't want to be engaging while they are building their bomb.
Facing this threat, a package of sanctions is the only sufficient way to stop Iran. Washington expected to have this package passed in a month.
What does Iran have to hide? Why is Iran refusing to live up to its international obligations, which would lead to political and economic integration with the international community that would actually benefit its people? Iran leaves the international community little choice but to impose greater costs for its provocative steps. Together, we are encouraging Iran to reconsider its dangerous policy decisions.
Washington's new pursuit to gain the most possible amount of support to stop Iran's sensitive nuclear activities extends from Saudi Arabia to China. It is expected that the U.S. will request Saudi Arabia, the second stop on Clinton's tour, to increase the kingdom's oil supplies to Beijing in order to gain the final vote for imposing new sanctions on Tehran.
The news now, and the threat posed by Iran's rogue nuclear program was at the top of the agenda in talks today between visiting chairman of the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral Mike Mullen, and top Israeli officials. More in this report.
Defense Minister Ehud Barak met this morning with the U.S. Army's chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral Mike Mullen, at his office at IDF headquarters in Tel Aviv. The two discussed the Iranian nuclear threat, trafficking of weapons by sea, and Syrian assistance for Hezbollah. We are working together to strengthen Israel's security, Barak said before the meeting. Between friends, there are sometimes differences, but we know how to overcome them and keep working together to strengthen regional stability. Before meeting, Mullen said the relations between the U.S. and Israel had always been good and that they would forever be so. Last night, Mullen spoke with reporters and explained the U.S.'s tough position on Iran.
My president's been very clear that from a policy standpoint, you know, Iran cannot have a nuclear weapon, nuclear capability. I wouldn't pick a specific date. The windows that the window that we've talked about is somewhere between 1 to 3 years. My leadership, my political leadership's been very clear about the intent to seek increased sanctions, and I think that's a very important step. I'm still hopeful that that diplomacy and sanctions and dialogue will achieve a solution.
Mullen met earlier with IDF Chief of Staff Gabi Ashkenazi and Military Intelligence Chief Major General Amos Yadlin. Mullen also met members of the Israeli delegation to Haiti during today's ceremony. He said they symbolized hope and the possibility of saving lives whenever possible. Mullen added that when he met Ashkenazi at the end of January, the IDF chief expressed extreme pride in his soldiers. He couldn't find the words to describe what he felt, the admiral said.
You represented hope so quickly in that terrible tragedy. For your ability to get there, your ability to organize, and your ability to do exactly what you just described, save lives, and do it quickly in what was a sea of tragedy.
Ashkenazi said that the delegation showed Israel and the IDF's true faces. I am proud to be your commander, he told the delegation members. Barak said he wished Mullen a successful tour of the region as he heads now to Jordan. Eli Wolgelernter, IBA News.
An Afghan army general said that his forces have regained control of most areas in Marja, which is home to a Taliban stronghold in the province of Helmand.
An Afghan government official said that 12 Taliban fighters were killed last night in battles with NATO forces in Helmand. The Helmand offensive is the largest military operation launched since the war on Afghanistan began in 2001.
From the images captured by news services, the offensive underway in Marja seems to be progressing slowly but surely. Casualties among coalition forces have been limited so far, as confirmed by NATO sources. This news comes 3 days after battles erupted in the Taliban stronghold of Helmand. Some NATO military leaders described the first days of the offensive as a good start. The leader said that Taliban fighters have withdrawn from the front lines and blended in among the local residents, warning that they may regroup and carry out attacks that could cause heavy casualties among NATO forces.
To be honest, it's a very good and encouraging start, which we didn't expect. The Taliban was surprised by the number of our combatant force and its heavy fire. We believe that they have blended in among the local residents, or probably left the area in order to launch attacks on our coalition forces.
On the ground, the spokesperson for the Helmand province said that 12 Taliban fighters were killed last night in clashes that erupted in various areas near the town of Marja. The spokesperson said that the joint forces have regained control of most areas in the city. The Afghan Minister of Interior said that several Taliban fighters who remained in Marja have formed limited pockets of resistance. The minister called on the Taliban to seize the opportunity and join the National Reconciliation Program.
The ones who are still remaining in the area.
Some who remain in the area have chosen to fight against the joint forces and, until yesterday, engaged in a limited resistance. Today we're sending them a message. The defense minister said that the best choice for the Taliban is to seize the opportunity and join the National Reconciliation Program and help restore peace in Afghanistan.
The best option is
وبحسب مراقبين فإن ترويج الناتو لعملية المشترك على نحو جيد قبل إطلاقها دفع مقاتلي طالبان.
Observers believe that the campaign that preceded the NATO joint offensive has prompted armed Taliban fighters to withdraw from the area. This helped the joint forces regain control of the region with a minimum number of casualties among Afghan civilians who may welcome the Afghan administration to the region. This may add a positive point to the strategy of U.S. President Barack Obama, who approved the deployment of 30,000 additional U.S. troops. The surge aims to help coalition forces regain control of areas under the control of the Taliban before U.S. troops withdraw from the country next year.
The official spokesperson for Yemen's Houthis said that they have handed over a captured Saudi soldier to the committee overseeing the ceasefire in Saada as a goodwill gesture by the group.
In another development, 6 people were killed and 25 others were wounded in 2 separate landmine explosions in the province of Saada. The Houthis started today to lift all military barriers in the provinces of Saada and Imran, north of Yemen, in accordance with the ceasefire.
Our correspondent, Murad Hashim, assesses the difficulties facing the committee overseeing the ceasefire in Saada.
Saada is breathing a sigh of relief following the announcement of a ceasefire there. Is it an actual end to the war in Saada or merely a short break before resuming the 7th war? Nobody can say for sure. Meanwhile, the ceasefire announced between the Yemeni government and the Houthi group is taking effect on the ground. The committees overseeing the ceasefire continue to reopen the roads and remove the landmines in the province. In addition, Houthi fighters have started to withdraw from their positions amidst alleged violations and delays.
The problem is that certain groups don't want peace because they are benefiting from the war. Others are afraid of peace because they are engaged in factional conflicts. They want guarantees that the peace will include them.
The 7-month-old confrontations have left death and destruction, not to mention the heavy toll left behind by Yemen's previous wars. Meanwhile, the committees overseeing the ceasefire in Saada are facing major obstacles on the ground, making their mission and efforts to bring life back to normal there difficult and costly.
We hope for peace. The Yemeni people want peace, not war. The war does not serve Yemen's interests. The war affects all aspects of life here, including the economy. It also causes division.
Articles of the ceasefire agreement are taking effect on the ground. Once the two sides complete the implementation process, ending with the withdrawal of armed fighters from mountains and the release of all prisoners of war and detainees, thousands of displaced Yemenis are expected to return to their original places of residence. Upon returning, the refugees will be met with a different type of hardship and suffering.
A U.S. drone attack has killed at least 4 people in northwestern Pakistan. A village in the North Waziristan tribal region was targeted. Officials say the unmanned aircraft fired a missile at a vehicle in the area. This is the second drone strike to hit North Waziristan in the past 24 hours. A similar attack left at least 7 people dead near the town of Mir Ali on Sunday. The U.S. has carried out dozens of drone attacks on Pakistan's tribal areas during the past year. Hundreds of civilians have died in the strikes. The U.S. claims it is targeting militants in the region, but Islamabad has repeatedly criticized the attacks, saying they mostly kill civilians and violate Pakistan's sovereignty.
Well, still in Pakistan, fresh confrontation between the government and the judiciary is threatening to worsen the already shaky political situation in that country. A large group of lawyers have held a rally against President Asif Ali Zardari in the capital, Islamabad. The move follows Zardari's appointments to the judiciary against the advice of Chief Justice Iftikhar Mohammed Chaudhry. Within hours of the president's move, the Supreme Court suspended Zardari's appointments, saying they are not constitutional. Meanwhile, opposition leader Nawaz Sharif has said the confrontation is the biggest threat to Pakistani democracy. In theory, the Supreme Court has the power to disqualify Zardari for breaking the law. The president's already strained relations with the judiciary worsened after the Supreme Court removed his immunity against prosecution last November.
On a visit to Moscow, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said he asked Russian President Dmitry Medvedev to back sanctions with teeth targeting Iran's energy sector. Netanyahu met Medvedev in the Kremlin as he seeks to harden the resolve of major powers for additional sanctions against Iran. Iran's announcement that it has begun making higher-grade nuclear fuel has heightened Western suspicions and sparked greater worry in Moscow about Tehran's true intentions. But Iran denies it is trying to make an atomic bomb. Israel, seeing a threat, has hinted it could launch a preemptive attack on Iran's nuclear facilities if it deems international diplomacy a dead end. Israel has repeatedly asked Russia to scrap a contract to sell an air defense system known as the S-300 to Iran. Netanyahu said he received assurances from Medvedev that Moscow understood the seriousness of the issues involved for regional stability. In the latest violence in Iraq, a bomb attack targeted the headquarters building of a political party in northern Baghdad, wounding one guard. The building was also damaged. The attack targeted the headquarters of the Coalition of Free Labor and National Salvation in a neighborhood of northern Baghdad. Earlier, two bombs planted near an electricity generator in southern Baghdad went off, killing one civilian and wounding three others. Also in the Iraqi capital, three roadside bombs in different areas killed one child and wounded four others. Overall violence has fallen sharply in Iraq in the last 2 years, but huge bombings have rocked the country in recent months. Iraqi and U.S. officials hope an upcoming election will solidify the country's young democracy ahead of a U.S. military withdrawal by drawing former insurgents and militias into the political process.
Gaza International Airport, considered the Gaza Strip's only lung, has become an open square with a pile of broken rocks. This is the result of several attacks by Zionist occupation aircraft and tanks. Our correspondent, Suleiman Abu Sita, visited the airport and brought us the following report.
There is no sign of life here. This is how Gaza's airport, located east of Rafah City, appears, but only at first glance. Inside, a woman is looking to make a living. There are also other people in here using the winter season and the deserted airport to plant the seeds of hope. This man lives close to the airport and has been suffering for a long time. What happened around here when the shelling took place?
A great deal of shelling took place here.
The man then told us what went on over here.
The plane came at 1 a.m. They shelled the entire area and the airport. They destroyed the airport and its lobby. They also destroyed people's homes. The windows and doors were destroyed. People fled their homes.
This is what the occupation missiles left. The children are innocent, and the adults are still looking for anything that can ease their pain under the siege. The children may sometimes carry this misery as well. Here they find some used construction material. They reuse them to build their houses. This airport remains, but its activities have come to an end. It's done as an airport and remains as a witness to the level of the Zionists' brutality. It's just one of the many witnesses. Military towers and cordoned off zones are located near the airport, and no resident from the Shalka village is allowed to approach them. This woman and her son are looking for a livelihood, but they may find death. The residents of this village have been suffering for a long time. The mayor of the town of Shalka believes that the purpose of the attack is to impose a new type of aggression on the border areas.
Last night, Israeli air forces and their aircraft targeted Gaza airport in the middle of the night. The purpose is to impose a new order and maybe expand the Israeli invasion and raids into the border areas of the region of Shalka.
The border areas remain a source of suffering. Their residents lost their fields and cannot replant them. They lost their houses and cannot rebuild them. When it comes to the Palestinians, all they have is hope. Suleiman Abu Sita, Al-Aqsa.
أعلنت وزارة الداخلية في حكومة حماس المقالة أنها اعتقلت صحفياً.
The Ministry of the Interior of the ousted Hamas government announced the arrest of a British journalist by the name of Paul Martin. The ministry said that the detained journalist confessed to violating Palestinian laws and undermining its national security. The General Prosecutor's Office ordered the British journalist to be held for 15 days, adding that the British consulate has been informed of the incident. The British journalist, who is a documentary photographer, arrived to the Gaza Strip Sunday morning. In response to what was aired by Israeli television, Palestinian Chief of Staff Rafiq al-Husseini said that he was the victim of entrapment and blackmail, targeting him financially and politically, as well as targeting his activities in Jerusalem.
I sent a message to His Excellency President Abu Mazen this morning. In it, I told him that I put my fate in his hands and those of the investigative committee that he formed. I'd like to add that I was ambushed by a gang that works for the Israeli intelligence. This stage tape, which was broadcast by Israeli Channel 10, is more than 1.5 years old, and at the time I informed the president of it.
أكثر من سنة ونصف وقد أبلغت سيادة الرئيس بذلك في حينه.
This gang tried to blackmail me with the tape, which I will not submit to. I will not submit to. This gang tried to blackmail me financially and politically, which means that I should abandon my work in Jerusalem and leave the homeland.
Thousands of Lebanese rallied in downtown Beirut to mark the 5th anniversary of the assassination of former Prime Minister of the Lebanese government, Rafiq al-Hariri. At this year's commemoration, the March 14 Alliance is in fact quite different from what it used to be when it was first founded following Hariri's assassination.
This is what Beirut looked like on February 14, 2005. A grand explosion killed the former head of the Lebanese government, Rafiq al-Hariri. Many described the incident as an earthquake that led Lebanon into numerous crises. Today, at the 5th anniversary of Hariri's assassination, the opening remarks of the March 14th Alliance focused on supporting the special tribunal for Lebanon to try those involved in the assassination and on Lebanon's engagement in the process of Arab reconciliation in order to turn a new page in Lebanon's relations with Syria.
My visit to Damascus was part of the grand window opened by the servant of the two holy shrines, King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz. I will be faithful in keeping this window open and building a new phase in the relations between Lebanon and Syria.
Lebanon is an Arab country, but it's an Arab country with independent sovereignty. Lebanon hangs on to its independence, sovereignty, and the right to make decisions without outside interference.
The need to further explain the relations with Syria appeared to be very important for the supporters of the March 14th Alliance after a hostile speech against Damascus was delivered in 2005. The improvement of this relation and the issue of Hezbollah's weapons maintained the barriers for some March 14th Alliance members, especially the Falangist Party and the Lebanese forces.
In my opinion, it demands deep reconciliation, and dispelling all the barriers and fears that exist among the different parties is essential. The purpose is to build a foundation for an effective reconciliation.
The one-state principle is the effective resistance. The Lebanese government alone is responsible for the security of Lebanon and its people.
Contrary to previous years, Druze leader Walid Jumblat visited Rafiq al-Hariri's grave without giving a speech at the ceremony to prove his separation from the March 14th Alliance, which put the parties allied with Syria and Hezbollah at ease. In the opinion of many political observers, the position of the March 14th Alliance on such a day remained within the framework of the national position in general, in which the two basic sides followed. The two sides that had conflicts in the past came together today to experiment with one unified national government. Mohammed Loon, BBC, Beirut. Preparations for the country's elections are underway and have been a success so far. Darfur's political leadership carries a historical burden on its shoulders. Since the peace process started going forward, citizens have focused their efforts on building a new era of national unity.
The state of North Darfur is witnessing a great deal of political activities as it aims to conduct the elections on time. Darfur is wearing a peaceful dress, which has become the cornerstone for the success of the democratic process and for taking the country towards a future comprised of freedom, democracy, and stability in all areas.
According to the timetable, we published the final list of the candidates running in North Darfur. After we looked into the decision made by the High Electoral Commission, 10 candidates submitted their objections against it. 2 of the appeals were accepted and 8 were denied.
The High Electoral Commission in North Darfur is fulfilling its national duty by making sure that the legal procedures are followed and that the elections are transparent. The lists of the candidates running for all the positions in the state have already been published, including the positions for the governorship, the members of the National and State Council, as well as those positions pertaining to women's affairs.
We have started, thank God, the preparations for the election campaigns that will start on March 13th. We have invited all the candidates to a meeting so we can talk about the election campaigns regulations, which are based on the law and the general election rules.
In adherence to the spirit of consultation, the High Electoral Commission, headed by Mr. Ser Al-Mak, continues to hold meetings to explain the election details pertaining to all the activities that will take place in the state, including coordination with the media and security agencies, and in order to ensure that the elections are successful.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.